Sway.
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 In the morning.
In the morning.
In the morning.
Don't shave your body.
Wake your fuck ass up then.
Crust out y'all.
Sway in the morning, shave 4-5. I take great honor. Great honor in our next guest, man. One of the Bay Area's greatest hip hop producers of all time.
All times.
I'm from the Bay.
Oh, man, it's rigged.
It's not a rig.
You already know, Heather.
Heather, stop. This is the godfather of the Bay Area mob sound. That's what we call him.
That's right.
He launched many careers. Mm. I'm only going to give you a few.
All right, talk to me, homie. Let me know.
Selly Cell.
Selly Cell.
TQ.
TQ.
Mac Maul.
Mac Maul.
Keek the Sneak. Rick Rock, the producer.
I know, I know.
Who was one of the architects of the whole hyphy sound. Am I wrong, Mike?
Nah, you right. Very right.
Chime in, Mike.
Sebo. E-40.
For shizzle, my dizzle.
And even Tupac. Ladies and gentlemen, the one and only Mike Mosley.
What's up? What's up? How you doing? What's up with it, Sway?
Mike, man, I love you, bro.
Love you too, fam. I already know.
Good to have you here, man. It's been a friend of mine for decades. Who can say that?
Man.
Who got friends for more than one decade?
Mm. That's right.
We came up in the trenches together. Interesting thing about the Bay Area, you have so many facets working at the same time and different people getting creating different lanes in different ways.
That's right.
Right?
That's right.
And this whole Bay Area sound has been digested, chewed up, digested, pissed out, shitted out. By many others who come in, they tap into that Bay Area energy, they pick up the game, they incorporate it into their music, into their swag, into their style. All this dancing and all how dudes are looking and talking and walking now.
Where it come from?
That's the Bay Area. That's the yay. Northern Cali.
Yeah. That's right.
Mike, how'd you get started, man?
Man, just being in Fairfield, you know what I'm saying, and 40 would come through, we was, you know, street hustlers or whatever, you bump your heads and... He came to my house one day and saw I was doing music, and he was like, "I rap, you know. Can I just do something?" So I'm like, "Man, come on." He started coming over, laying on my floor, and we just started going to the studio practicing, and then we ended up starting getting, you know, recognized, you know, like I say, from the Bay. I mean, from like people in Oakland, you know, such as yourself. Y'all really wasn't. They wasn't really feeling. Northern Fairfield and Vallejo. Yeah.
Talk about
what,
okay, so no,
yeah,
he's talking.
I was going to say, what's Fairfield? Ooh. What is Fairfield Vallejo? What is that?
Turn Tracy on. Yeah, okay, now see, this is interesting.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so because it's interesting you say that. Because it took the Bay Area. Fairfield is about how many, 30 minutes, 20 minutes outside of north of Oakland, in between Sacramento and Oakland.
So it's like another borough comparing it to New York.
Yeah.
Okay.
You got Fairfield, you got Vallejo, you got Sassoon, you got, you know, as you head north out of the Bay Area.
Right.
And those are, for Oakland, in our mind, that was like more suburban.
Suburbs.
Little
squares out there. Okay. Yeah.
That's what we thought. It was a little slow maybe. Coming up, but we didn't know.
Yeah,
you know, we didn't know these boys were savages out there.
Right,
you
know.
Hyenas?
But it's true. Yeah. People weren't gravitating towards that sound more than they were the East Bay sound. Would you agree?
Yeah, definitely. You know what I mean? Because it was short. You know what I mean? It was, you know, Short's whole camp, everybody he had. You know what I mean? Then it was Richmond. Then it was what's the guy?
Tyree
Calvin T.
Okay,
Calvin T. From Richmond, and then it trickled down to Fairfield, 40, E-40. And Be Legit, and Selly Cell.
You had Kyrie and those guys,
Kyrie
too. Mac Maul.
Mac Maul,
okay.
In the Vallejo, So, you know, we basically were seeing what you guys were doing, you know, in Oakland. And we was like, man, we do that too. So we started practicing, and we started dumping records out, and we got hot. And then, you know, Jive came and gave 40 a deal. That's when we started our professional career.
Oh, they started making more money than us too. I remember that, man. We were so angry.
We went in.
I was upset. When did you first meet Pac?
I met Pac in 93-94 at this Jack the Rapper, actually. And my homeboy, Almost High, introduced me to him.
Well, Jack the Rapper was a
convention
that used to take place.
Yeah, music.
I think it was around the time Freaknik was happening, too.
Okay.
And this was when he had just got done filming Poetic Justice.
Oh,
so
man.
Pac would just literally be walking around by himself, and there would be droves of females following this dude. It was like crazy to me, you know right? So, but what happened is, he came up to me and he was like, "Man, I've been wanting to meet you. I'm a fan of Selly Cell. My favorite song is Bailing Through the Hood by Selly Cell that you did. I love that Sebo when I was in jail. I work out to SIBO. Wow. You know what I mean? So you liked all that hood stuff that I did. And I was like, shocked. I'm like, man, I want to work with you because I'm going to get a plaque working with you.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So he's like, let's do it. And so every next week, you know, he launched my whole get into the industry as far as, you know, how they send a car for you and do everything.
Mm-hmm.
Send you a car, get the studio for you, get you the hotel room. That was like amazing to me. I'm like, this really happens? You could, this is a business?
Yeah.
I was shocked, you know, so that's what really turned me out as far as being a professional.
Yeah. What songs did you do with Pac?
I did on Me Against the World album. Yep. I did Heavy in the Game. Can You Get Away?
Yeah.
All Eyes on Me. I did with Rick Rock, we did Trade War Stories.
Uh-huh.
And We Ain't Hard to Find.
Uh-huh.
Then another album I did, we did I'm Getting Money. Uh-huh. I forgot which album it was.
Uh-huh.
Then I did Getting Money, Good Life. Uh-huh. I did, matter of fact, we did The Good Life the night that he did Hit Him Up. So after he did Hit Him Up in the studio, we turned around and did The Good Life. And I got footage of that.
You got footage of him? What was the conversation like before he did Hit Him Up? Like, did he write it there? Or
he wrote it on the spot. So I actually had called Goody Mob, because Bernard Parks, and he was managing the Goody Mob and him at the time. So I called him and had them come through. Strangely enough, I had to look at the video footage to remember who was there.
Yeah.
It was so long ago.
Yeah.
I was drinking Hennessy.
Uh-huh.
So, that Henny.
So Left Eye was there at the mixing board, which is crazy.
When he did Hit Him Up?
When he did Hit Him Up.
Uh-huh.
I had Goody Mob come. CeeLo wasn't there, but the rest of Goody Mob came through with Bernard and Big John, of course. Big John Platt, I had him come through. Uh-huh. Suge stuck his head in there and dipped out. Suge never really looked. He wasn't even around. When I did sessions with Pac,
yeah,
he was like in and out. It wasn't even on no craziness at all. He was just a real cool dude, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the attitude and the conversation, of course, Outlaws was there too.
Uh-huh.
The conversation was ready for war. And he was jokingly, like he would play it. He would go back and forth and he would play it. And he was like laughing and like, I got him. Like he knew he really did something.
Yeah.
So he wasn't really talking crazy. It's just that he was going off so crazy in the vocal booth at the end of the song that the mics were short out. And,
yeah.
Like it just was craziness, you know? And we did that like at 3-4 in the morning.
And he laughed. He was laughing about it.
He wow. wasn't in no angry, crazy mood. He was like laughing. It was like a joke to him.
Uh-huh.
But he did it so easily and so quickly. And so he would come back and then we'd sit in that little small room just like this. And he would constantly keep playing it and playing and playing it over. And after he got done, we ended up started doing The Good Life.
Did you produce Hit 'Em Up?
No.
Oh,
no.
You were just let's hear a little bit of Hit 'Em Up, man. Mm-hmm. But Mike Mosley just played some just gave us some hits. Every time Wonder, listen, I'll be honest with you. Yeah. Every time Wonder plays Hit 'Em Up, because Wonder loves Hit 'Em Up.
Uh-huh.
And I loved it when it came out, but since both Biggie and Pac got, you know, killed, I don't like caring. It's just the energy of it.
Oh, is that right?
The energy of it kind of drags me.
Does it?
You know, like, I don't like certain people that I knew that I was close to.
Yeah.
You know, it's that energy kind of drags me. But since you put that context to it, it makes me want to hear it now.
Yeah, it was a fun jokingly matter how he did it.
Yeah, see, and I didn't know
the content was going for the juggling now.
Yeah.
But he wasn't like that at all.
It was a rap thing for
him.
Yeah.
Yeah. Completely. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. It was a rap thing.
Straight rap thing, dude. Straight rap. It was nothing else but that.
Power of history.
It was Meek and Drake.
Yeah, basically.
Not quite.
Nah.
Right.
Nah.
I wouldn't say all that now.
Mike was looking at me like, I can't believe you made that analogy.
Yeah.
Damn, dude. I know you realer than that. Let's hear it real quick. I'm going to come back and talk more with Mike Mosley. 888-742-3345. You want to talk to him, give us a call.
Got single cell or something.
Damn.
You fucking with me, nigga. Fuck around, have a seizure, a heart attack. You better back the fuck up, cause you get smacked the fuck up.
And you say Pac was laughing when he did that part.
He was laughing.
It was funny.
Turn it up. Fuck you and your motherfucking mama.
Damn! All right. Real love. And you said he was laughing. Like, oh, man, this is good.
Hilarious. He was laughing. I'm telling you. Smoking plenty of blunts and cigarettes. Cracking up.
Cracking up.
I got footage of it, I'm telling you. And
wow.
I don't know how I got a camera inside of that studio, because you had to come through a metal detector to get it in, and that was taking anything you had. How I got a camera in there, I don't know.
You had a plastic camera.
No, that's
yeah.
Pac had a tendency, I remember hanging out with him, and he just kind of held court.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He'll just kind of get on the pulpit and just start talking about society, talking about our lives, what we need to do, so on and so forth. Right. Did he do that in the studio?
Nah, he wasn't doing that then.
Yeah?
When my experiences with Pac were work. Only time he was really like on some real conversations when we were doing Can You Get Away?
Mm-hmm.
After he just got done cussing out Tom Wiley and his assistant.
Tom Wiley was an executive at Interscope Records.
And
I did a production deal through Tom Wiley.
Did you?
Yeah.
Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah. Sway?
Yeah. That's crazy, okay. Sway.
You know, I don't talk about my history. I fucking start counting your dollars.
You know what I'm saying? You real low with that, too.
Yeah, you know that. You PK.
Real low. He real low real with that. Low, yeah. That's how Bay dudes do. But anyway, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So he was talking about that situation.
Yeah, he was talking about that. And so he was talking about, he was really kind of stressed out about going to jail for that whole rape thing. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So he was real in like a down type of mood. So he wasn't really, he was like, man, I can't believe they did that to me. You know, I was this and this and that. It wasn't even me. And you know what I'm saying? He was just really apologetic on that. And then he turned around and went in on Janet Jackson.
Oh, because she wanted him to take the HIV test in order to kiss him.
Yeah.
With poetic justice.
That's right. Yeah, he wasn't feeling it. He was mad about that.
She said she won't kiss him unless he take an HIV test. And he said he'll take it if we can have sex.
Yeah.
Yo, I love it. Oh, that would have been retweeted 1,000 times in this.
Yo, you know that one, Heather?
No, I knew that, but I'm just sitting here thinking, did she do that with Eddie and Nutty Professor?
Nope. You know she didn't. You know she didn't.
Wow, that's crazy.
That's wild.
Yeah. Man, we got some people on the phone lines right now, and they want to holler at you, man. We got Jackie from Detroit on the line.
Jackie,
good morning.
Jacqueline.
How you doing?
What up? Hey, how y'all doing? Good morning.
What up, though? What up, though?
Hello to Mike Mosley.
I just want to know, like, how does it feel to be a legend in the game and to create this beautiful history for hip-hop?
You know what? Sometimes I got to step outside myself because I don't feel it. I don't understand because it's me. You know what I mean? I'm real humble like that. So only thing I can relate it to is when I see somebody that I like that does something, I'd be like, man, that dude is dope, or this person did that. Then I can kind of relate to how you feel or other people view me. But me being me, it kind of feels regular to me.
I got one more question. What would you tell people that's trying to come up in the game?
I would say be humble and stay consistently working on your craft as much as you possibly can. And the club and everything else, everything else everybody else is doing isn't important. Stick to doing what it is that you do and do it every day, all day. Mm. And something's going to happen for you.
All right, Jackie. Jackie, you're a citizen.
A sway in the morning, sis.
Thank you for your call. Okay, Nicole's on the line. She's from Cali. What's
up,
Nicole? Hey, Nick. Good morning. Good. I love you guys. We listen every day at my house.
Oh, that's what's
we
up.
Love you too, hey, Nicole.
You and your family are citizens.
A sway in the morning.
Thank you. I just love the history that you guys provide us every morning, and it just brings me back to the first time I heard E-40. I went to high school in Vacaville. I graduated in 1994, and I got my first taste out of the back of his van.
Wow.
Thank you for the history, and I just appreciate it. Love you guys.
Wait, hold on, Nicole. You said you got what?
I got my first E-40, the click, taste out of the back of their van.
Yeah.
What was you doing in the back of their van?
Well, I wasn't in the back of the van.
Oh, okay.
You know, they were out at underneath.
I'm messing with you, Nicole. I'm messing with you. They used to sell their music out of a trunk, basically.
I thought she said the whole time she got her first piece at the back of the van. Listen, I was like, she went in.
Right. That's Nicole, right? Scotty is in Compton.
The first
she got a case.
Scotty, what's up?
What's up, Sway? Top of the morning, Sway in the morning crew.
Same to you, fam. We got Mike Mosley in here.
What's going on, man?
Mike Mosley, top of the morning, man. I enjoy your work. I didn't never meet you.
Appreciate it.
I just about street promoted all of your music.
Wow, that's heavy. Appreciate
you. Me and Sway used to hang up posters back in the day.
You remember that? Oh, that's Scotty?
Hey, man. That's Scotty D, DJ Aladdin uncle.
Oh my gosh.
Your G.
Wow. Wow.
Do you know him?
I know him.
All the promotion.
Yeah, DJ. Wait, hold up, Scott. DJ Aladdin is probably one of the illest DJs to come out of just to come out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you want to speak on that, Scotty? Oh, this phone line hung up.
Damn. No, he there.
What happened? Shit. Scotty. Okay. There you go.
King T is my little brother. And King T is my little brother.
King T is your little brother?
Wow.
We just talked about that. Wow. That's crazy. Wow. King T is your little brother. What's up with DJ Latin, man?
Latin is good. He's doing real good things right now. He just shot a video. But, man, let's stick to the stuff. You can hit me on the line, man. I've been trying to catch up with you for a minute, but I'm on the road right now.
Catch up with me?
Just coming from the East. Yeah.
Hold on the line. Giselle, I'm going to get your information. I'm going to text you mine. Is this your cell phone you calling from?
Yeah, it's my cell phone. Right
now. Okay, hold on the line, man. Hold on.
Wow.
Yeah, shit, Mike, you bring them out, baby.
You know what I'm saying? Bring them out.
Yeah, man. It's like, this is your life, swiggity. Okay, there we go. All right, man. Okay, so real quick, man, you got you're producing a lot of TV and stuff, right?
Man, I'm doing TV shows. I worked on one with Floyd Mayweather's baby mom, Melissa Renee.
Yeah.
We shot that. You know what I'm saying? Came out real crispy. Like, mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And then I just shot this thing called Pole Magic with some of my partners from Australia. It's real dope. You know, sexual. It's like a power empire-ish type of thing, but it's kind of around a strip club type thing.
Okay.
I'm going to send that link to y'all so y'all can see that.
Yeah, I want
to
see that.
It's real clean.
OQ, you want to see that one too?
Yeah
I'm sure. Yeah. All right. And what's going on with the phone thing you're doing?
So, you know, the industry really, Sway, is driven by Apple, Spotify. It's really ran by tech dudes. Mm-hmm. They're not music dudes.
Right.
So the industry, and at the same time, we're being stuck up and being told, okay, well, we only owe you a couple pennies. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We made a bunch of billions, but here's a couple pennies for the music that's really our business, core of our business, right? So my JT, of course, another hustler.
The bigger figure. Out of San Francisco. Filmo. No,
he and ATL.
Filmore is an area in San Francisco, is a street in the area in San Francisco. JT, the bigger figure, put the game out early, had his own. He's had record labels since...
Since then, he was like first youngster to get a deal at Priority.
That's right, Priority Records. Yeah.
So he
had a production deal at Priority Records.
Fuck out of here!
I swear on everything.
Oh my gosh!
So he was selling these tablets. He was like, man, I'm doing these tablets and they're coming preloaded with my catalog and this and that, this and that. And it made sense to me. I'm like, you know what? A person would rather spend $150 or $500 on a cell phone with some free music on it than they would to buy a CD, hands down. So I was like, man, that makes sense. So, you know, we go to China and just press them up and we doing them out the trunk like we normally do and get some of that tech money and just take it back into our own hands. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
So that's pretty much what
so
it is.
So you get the phone and a catalog of music?
Yes. Because they get it for free anyway.
For a one-time fee?
Yeah.
I'm smart.
That's interesting.
Yeah, it's almost like a T-shirt.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, pressing up a T-shirt. So it's the same difference.
So how can people get one of the phones?
Just got to go to Get Rich Wireless.
GetRichWireless.com.
And do your pre-order right now.
GetRichWireless.com, man. Go ahead and support my man Mike Mosley, man. And by the way, Tracy, I should say, when I say I had, it was King Tech. And me. So
yes.
My partner,
right.
King
of
Tech.
Of course. Shout out to King Tech.
King Tech is also an executive producer of everything I do on TV and even putting this show together
coming
to Sirius XM.
Oh, that's good. I like that.
It's always us.
You always been that like that dude, though.
Yeah, man.
Good man, Sway.
Hey man, can you thank you, Tracy. I feel legitimized when you said that. Mike,
yes.
You gonna play something for us? We got these hyenas waiting in the hallway.
Hyenas!
Look at them. All right.
What we gonna play? What we playing? What you want me to play?
You play? Give me something to treat.
Play that song y'all never probably heard. This is a song Tom Wiley, It Was Too Much For You.
What was it called?
I Wonder If Heaven Got a Ghetto.
By?
Tupac.
This is it.
He didn't even want it though.
Sway in the Morning, Shade 45.
It's Sway in the Morning, only on Shade 45.